Now let us begin our discussion of the experimental skills. Here we will cover the following points shown on the slide. First, we will illustrate what is the meaning of the scientific method with an example. Then we will see variables and errors in experiments. Then what is meant by control, precision and accuracy. And finally, we will mention in passing how to fit a straight line to measured data. Let us look at the scientific method. What does it involve? One can broadly identify four steps in this method. First is the observation of phenomena. Then based on the observation and our thinking, we come up with a hypothesis about some happening in the world around us. The hypothesis is some sort of an imaginative explanation for things which we observe. However, it is not verified to be correct. So, hypothesis is a sort of statement of explanation for the phenomena which is not yet verified to be correct. So, it is mostly based on intuition. Then comes the important step of verification of the hypothesis. So, here broadly there are three steps: experiment, observation and inference. If one wants, one can club this entire thing, step of verification, all the three steps of experiment, observation and inference in just one word, that is experiment. And after the experiment and the inference drawn from it, you make a generalization to all situations which may be similar to that considered in the experiment. Now let us look at the various elements of this method in little bit more detail. See, observation. Observation is not a passive acquisition of sensory information, but a critical, purposeful process needing a high level of awareness. This high level of awareness is very, very important for being a good observer. Because when you say that you should be observant, what does it mean? What is it that you are supposed to observe? So when you ask a student, if the student is doing some chemical reaction and then you tell him you be observant and see how variables in the reaction are changing. The point is, you are not telling him what are all the variables that the student should observe. It is not possible to tell also, because after all you are doing a new experiment. It is your duty to be aware as much as possible to identify as many variables which may be affecting the experiment. So it is in this sense a very high level of awareness is what is expected if you want to be a good observer, because you cannot tell beforehand what are the things that you should observe. So for example, you are doing a chemical reaction and you are concentrating on measuring the temperature, but at the same time the reaction is being done in an environment where there is light, because otherwise you cannot see what is going on. It is possible that lighting may have an effect. So like this, it all depends on a person, how much aware he is. Okay, depends on the awareness whether you are able to observe the presence of a variable which is affecting the reaction. So there is a reason why we choose to observe a specific portion of the whole domain of possible objects of observation. So it is not as though something that is very evident to your eye or something that can be heard very clearly alone is chosen for observation. You are aware of several things that are happening around you, but then even though you are aware of all the things, you choose only a part of those things that you are aware of for critical inquiry and careful observation. Hypothesis. Hypothesis is an imaginative preconception or an inspired guess about some particularly interesting aspect of the world. Every discovery begins as a hypothesis. Okay? Now, hypothesis is based on intuition. It may or may not be correct. We will illustrate this with examples. Now, what is experiment? Experiment is the act undertaken to verify a hypothesis. It discriminates between possibilities and gives direction for further thought. This is another role of experiment. It discriminates between possibilities. It is a happening device to apprehend the truth. So it is a set of conditions that you ensure in order to observe a particular thing. So for example, if you want to detect the wave nature of matter, then you have to devise conditions, special conditions, so that this wave nature will become evident. If you want to detect the particle nature of light, you have to devise special conditions, okay, to detect that particular aspect. For knowing the wave nature of light, you may not have to devise special conditions, because already the conditions which are existing in the environment may be sufficient for you to observe easily the wave nature of light. So here you are not devising special conditions. It is a method of discovering causal interconnections. So what is experiment? Another way of looking at experiment is it is a method of discovering causal interconnections. Hypothesis. Devising a hypothesis that can be tested by practical experiments is an art. So every hypothesis may not be, it may not be possible to test every hypothesis in a scientific way or to establish whether it is true or not. For example, the hypothesis all men are mortal, it is not something that you can test. It is not possible to scientifically examine this hypothesis, all men are mortal. Then how do you frame a hypothesis? That is also important. So there is a method of framing the hypothesis, it is called null hypothesis, that is hypothesis stated in negative terms. I will leave it as an assignment to you to see this point in detail. What is the meaning of a null hypothesis or framing a hypothesis in negative terms? In a very simple way, I could put it as follows. Suppose you make a hypothesis, some conditions A result in effect B. So A implies B, that is your hypothesis, suppose. Now, an equivalent statement of the same hypothesis would be, if there is no B, there is no A. A implies B is equivalent to saying B bar implies A bar. B bar means not B. Supposing you are making a hypothesis, some variable A results in an effect B. It is same as saying, if you do not see the effect B, then it means A is not present. Not B implies not A, or no B implies no A. Now, this statement and any of these statements are equivalent. But when you frame the statement in this form, not B implies not A, no B implies no A, that is, if you don't find the effect B, then you can be sure that the condition A is absent. This form of framing the hypothesis is called a null hypothesis. Normally, people say that to test a hypothesis, it is better if you test its null form of a hypothesis. So more about this, I leave it as an assignment, because framing of hypothesis itself is a important, and there are several details about this. Now, we will consider an example to illustrate this particular aspect of the scientific method. In the West, one observes a high level of prevalence of obesity. So there is a large number of people who are obese. In fact, about 50% of the population is overweight. This is an observation. So naturally, people are concerned about it. So some scientists working on the issue of obesity and removal of obesity, they hypothesized that the overweight people are overweight because they have a higher level of hunger than the average weight people. because they have a higher level of hunger, they eat more and therefore they become overweight. So the fact that people are overweight is one observation. The fact that overweight people are seen to eat more is also an observation. And then you are trying to frame a hypothesis by intuition. What is the cause of overeating? What is the cause of overeating? So the cause of overeating is more hunger. Now, some scientists came up and said, look, I don't accept this hypothesis that the hunger, the higher level of hunger is the cause of overeating. I want to test whether it is true. So he suggested an experiment, or rather he carried out an experiment. Now his experiment was as follows. He took 100 overweight people and 100 average weight people. This group of 200 people was divided into two groups of 100 people each. Each group of 100 people had 50 overweight people and 50 average weight people. Now each of the two groups were given sandwiches to eat. So one group of 100 was put in one room and each person was given one sandwich to eat. The other group of 100 people was put in another room and they were given three sandwiches to eat. And people in both the rooms were told that if they do not want, they need not eat. Or if one sandwich is not sufficient to satisfy their hunger, they can go and fetch another or more sandwiches from room which was kept about 50 meters away. So they can bring sandwiches from there and eat if one sandwich is not sufficient. Now after carrying out this experiment, they measured what is the average number of sandwiches eaten by the overweight people and the average weight people. Now very interestingly, they found that on average, the average weight people ate only one sandwich in both the rooms. So in the room where, the average weight people ate two sandwiches in both the rooms, which means in room number one, where only one sandwich was provided, most of them fetched one more sandwich. In the second room, they left out one sandwich. They didn't eat all the three sandwiches. However, overweight people, the behavior was different. In room number one, most of them ate only one sandwich. Whereas in room number two, most of them ate all the three sandwiches. Now, this experiment showed that internal factors such as hunger may not explain this observation. Because in this case, it depends on the experimental conditions. Sufficient care was taken to see that everyone was sufficiently hungry and so on. There are many other details of the experiment, so which we will not go into here. We will assume that conditions were maintained identical in both rooms. But what it showed is that for the overweight people, the amount they eat depends on the availability of food, which is an external condition, not an internal condition to the person. So the eating habits of overweight people are stimulated by external conditions in the environment, more specifically availability of food. For the average weight people, however, there is an internal control mechanism. Independent of the amount of food available, they will eat, right? Some amount that is controlled. So this experiment therefore showed that you cannot assume hunger as the cause, or higher level of hunger as the cause for overeating. Of course, there have been further experiments and so on. Whatever I have said is a simplified form of the situation, but nevertheless it illustrates the importance of scientific approach. So what is the scientific approach? Scientific approach is you must verify the hypothesis. Nothing is accepted until you test. And you must devise an experiment. So that is also important in science. How do you think of an experiment to test your hypothesis? And testing of the hypothesis doesn't mean that you should prove it. Even if you disprove a statement, right? Even if you disprove a statement, it is significant. Now, the lack of scientific method, however, or scientific approach is very prevalent in society. Now, before I give an example of a non-scientific method, right, I want to emphasize the fact that it is possible that not every hypothesis can be tested. We have already said this. Okay? So there are many things which you may not be able to test by the scientific method, devise an experiment and test. And you cannot say that what is not possible to test by a scientific approach is not true. That is not the kind of thing, the statement that we are making. But for our purpose of research, right, in a wider philosophical sense, it may be true that everything cannot be, the truth, all aspects of truth cannot be scientifically tested. It may be true. Here we are only talking about research in science and engineering, or humanities, even humanities, where you can test things scientifically. But when you say testing scientifically, you should be clear what it means. So what it means is, in a scientific method, two important elements are there, a hypothesis and an experiment. So both things are important. An example of not using verification. It happens very often in life. But a significant example of this is the belief of, I forget whether it was Aristotle or Socrates, okay, one of these two. So this philosopher believed that women had less teeth than men. Now this is a hypothesis. It was based on intuition. And once, since the philosopher was well established and well known, people also believed this statement. And this happened for several hundred years. Now no one attempted to ask a woman to open the mouth and simply test, check how many teeth she has. This is very interesting. Why? Because the person who made the statement was very well established and regarded as a good thinker. So we must be aware that very often we might use non-scientific approach, and we may have beliefs which are not tested. We must always try to test the beliefs as far as possible. Okay? So this is an example of thinking based on only intuition. Very often all our hypotheses are based on intuition. Without intuition you cannot work. So we are not saying that intuition is bad. Intuition is very, very important. In fact, only intuition can give you a hypothesis. But intuition is not sufficient. In scientific working, in working by scientific method, intuition alone is not sufficient. You must verify. The verification or experiment is very, very important. So now let us look at some other aspects of experiment, conducting experiments. Types of variables. Independent variable, stimulus, or input or cause. All these are synonymous terms. So this is the condition manipulated to determine its effect on an observed phenomenon. Then some variables can be dependent variables. So dependent variables are response or output or effect. So this is the condition that appears, disappears or varies as an independent variable is introduced, removed or varied. Very important point. In some cases, it may be difficult to decide which of a pair of variables is the cause and which is the effect. So just because you see there is a relationship between two variables are correlated, doesn't mean you will know which one is the independent variable and which is the dependent variable. Then, apart from independent and dependent variables, you also have another type of variables. They are called confounded variables. Confounded variable is one whose effect cannot be separated from the supposed independent variable. Now we can illustrate this with example. Suppose you are trying to find out if men and women have any specific preference for colors. You want to, now this is a hypothesis that you want to test whether there is a specific preference. Now you think, you take a group of men and group of women and then you do some experiments with them, okay? And you find some difference and you try to attribute that difference in preferences to the gender. But what you are not taking care of is the fact that these men and women are, they have a particular age. So over the years, they might have been exposed to particular type of colors. This is called past experience. You do not know. Supposing, because people are exposed to a particular type of color, they like it. They may develop a liking for it. Now this past experience is something, it is a confounded variable, because its effect you cannot separate out very easily. Therefore, if you can devise an experiment in which you can separate out the effect of the confounding variables or confounded variables, then that is something significant. So one must always be aware that there can be dependent variables, there can be independent variables, and there can be variables whose effect cannot be separated from that of other independent variables and confounded variables. So your experiment should not have confounded variables, or you should have some method of eliminating the effects. Or at least, if you cannot eliminate, you can at least state in your experiment that this is a confounded variable whose effect we have not been able to detect. Okay? Some other attributes of variables. Quantitative variable. It is something that varies in amount. You can assign a number for it. Categorical variable. It varies in kind. Gender is a categorical variable, right? Male or female. Continuous and discrete variables. So you can have variations of quantities in discrete manner or continuous manner. Now we have discussed the various types of variable in experiment. Let us look at another very important issue. Any experiment, you are making a measurement. Without a measurement, there is no experiment. I have emphasized this fact in my introduction, that measurement is very, very important. Just qualitative understanding of how, when one variable is increased, the other variable increases or decreases is not sufficient. Okay? That doesn't complete the experiment. You must measure. So that is where errors come in. So two types of errors can be there in measurement. Random errors. So random error varies and equally likely to be positive or negative. It is an error which is equally likely to be positive or negative. As against this, a systematic error is something which is constant within course throughout the experiment. The word constant is not to be taken literally. In fact, if you want, you can say non-random errors. You can say non-random errors. So random error is one which varies equally likely, which is equally likely to be positive or negative. That is the nature of random error. But systematic error, it has a certain trend, predictable trend. Okay? Traditionally, the word systematic error has been used, so therefore we will retain the error, retain this word. But you can understand this as a non-random error. And now let us illustrate with example. Supposing you are measuring the terminal velocity of a ball in viscous medium like glycerin. Suppose this is the experiment you are doing. Now let me draw a diagram to show that. So this experiment, all of us who are in engineering or physics would have done in our first year. Now this is a jar or a tube, and it is filled with glycerin, which is a viscous medium, and you drop a ball in this medium. Now the ball initially accelerates downwards because of gravity. But ultimately, it acquires a constant velocity because as its velocity increases, the viscosity produces a frictional force which increases with velocity. So for some velocity, the downward force because of gravity is exactly balanced by the frictional force or opposing force because of the viscosity of glycerin. If you were to drop the ball in vacuum, then it would accelerate continuously. It will not reach a constant velocity. Experiment is to measure the terminal velocity of this ball. Terminal velocity is a constant velocity that it acquires after some time. Now, how will you measure it? The common method of measuring is, you note, for example, when it crosses this particular mark with a stop clock. So you start a clock. Then when the ball crosses a different mark, you stop. So the clock would have come somewhere here. Some time has elapsed. Now you measure this distance and measure the time. And then the terminal velocity is given by distance by time. So this is the experiment. So in this experiment, what are the sources of error? And how do you classify the errors as random and systematic? As shown in this slide, random errors can occur in starting and stopping the clock or in estimating the ball location on a scale. Okay, so let us look at the diagram again. Now you say you are noting the time when the ball crosses this mark. Now are you noting when the bottom end of the ball is crossing the mark or when the top end of the ball is crossing, or is it that you are noting the middle? This is one point, and it may not be possible for you to precisely note any one of these. So there can be some error because you are repeatedly, when you do the experiment repeatedly, right, this is something that you are not able to determine precisely, and it can be random. Then starting and stopping of the clock. You are looking at the ball and at the same time you have to start the clock. So there can be a delay between the two events. So you may start the clock before the ball has crossed the particular mark, or you may do it a little bit later, and this thing cannot be controlled. So these are the two sources of random error in this experiment. These are examples of two sources of error which are random. Now what is the systematic error here that can happen? Now, supposing your clock after you start progressively becomes slow. This is an example of a systematic error. Or when you repeat the experiment, what happens is there is a friction between the ball and the glycerin. Now this friction causes the glycerin to heat up. After all, how is the energy dissipated? How is the friction, the energy dissipated because of friction? It is dissipated as heat. So the temperature of glycerin will go on rising if you take a very long time to complete your experiment. So this is another example of systematic error. So like this, in any experiment, you have either systematic errors or random errors. Now you should have the ability to distinguish between random and systematic errors, and you should also be aware of the fact that these errors are present and what are the sources of these errors, because only then you can reduce the errors. It is very, very important to reduce the errors. We will consider an example to illustrate why reducing errors is very, very important. So before we go to that particular example, let us see some further facts about errors. We normally use the terms accuracy and precision. So what is the meaning of accuracy? Now on the left hand side here, you see a point or a circle which can be regarded as the true value of the particular variable being measured. And the crosses around it indicate the values obtained in repeated experiments of the same. To give you an analogy, in fact, you can regard, imagine that this is this represents a shooting event where the solid circle is a target and the crosses indicate the places where the bullet strikes. Okay, when a person is trying to shoot at the target in repeated trials. Now you will say that the marksman is accurate if all these places where the bullet hits the somewhere near the target are very close to the target. All of them should be very close. So what it means is both systematic and random errors are small. So random errors are represented by the differences between the repeated measurements. And systematic error is represented by the difference between location of these crosses and the target. So here, for example, when all these crosses are very close to each other, but they are located away from the target, then you say that the measurement is precise but inaccurate. So precision has to do with ability to repeat the value in successive measurements, several trials. So you may be getting the same value in repeated measurements. That doesn't mean it is accurate, it means it is precise. So accuracy means this value should be very close to the true value. So systematic errors should not be there. Precision means random errors are minimum. Okay, but that doesn't mean systematic errors are absent. So imprecise and inaccurate, both systematic and random errors are present. So this is an important point that we should note, the difference between precision and accuracy. So precision means small random errors. Accuracy means both systematic and random errors should be small. Now when you write the reading, let us see, what are we pointing towards, the systematic error or the random error? Now here, for example, on this slide, you show the measurement of a resistance in some experiment. And you write the measurement as, the measured value as, one particular number plus or minus another number. So in this case, does plus or minus 0.001 ohm represent a systematic or random error? What does it represent? Evidently, it is random error because it is plus or minus. So it is equally likely to be positive or negative. So it is not systematic error. So note that when you report your measurements in this form, you are specifying the random error. You are not specifying the systematic error. Now, how do you detect and minimize errors? This is the next issue. Random errors can be detected by repeating the experiment. So when you repeat the experiment, if you are getting different values, then you become aware that there are random errors in the experiment. However, repeated measurements may or may not reveal systematic error. This is very important. You cannot reduce systematic error merely by repeating the experiment. Systematic errors are somewhat more difficult to detect and reduce. Random errors can always be eliminated by repeating the experiment. So many times the research scholars are not aware that when they are minimizing error by repeating the experiment, they are only removing the random error. Or let me not use the word remove, they are reducing the random error. You cannot remove systematic errors by this approach. So first of all, many times in fact the research scholars are not aware of the errors at all. Now how do you know whether a research scholar is aware of errors or not? You can easily see the way the readings are presented in graphical form, measurement. Okay? For example, if you find that some measurements are reported like this. So I show points, these are measured points. So measurement of y as a function of x. And then you say the behavior is something like this. Now clearly, the person who has drawn the diagram is not aware of errors. Because you assume that the measured value is precisely this point. Right? Whereas just now we have shown on the slide that supposing you are reporting measurement of resistance, you will report it as a value that you have read on the meter plus or minus a quantity. Plus or minus a quantity. That is a random error. Now I will not discuss in detail how do you decide the random error in a situation. Right? You can look at it. I am just initiating the whole discussion about the errors. So how do you know the research scholar is aware of the errors? Well, if he shows an error bar, if he shows the reading as a range, and then this value is the midpoint of this range. then you know that yes, the research scholar is aware of the errors. Now, why is this bar very important? Because now you see, if I take lowest point here, the highest point here, because this is also possible, and then the lowest point here, then I don't seem to discern any specific trend. Okay? But then you may say, this will happen all the time. The point is, what is this, what is the length of this bar? This is what is important. If the length of this particular bar is small, then you can definitely discern some trend. But if the length of this bar is long, which is what we have seen in our lectures yesterday when we discussed about graphical approach and so on, okay, how to represent data in graphical form, then you may not be able to discern trend, any trend. In such a case, if you are reporting that you have discerned some trend, then your conclusion can be in doubt. Now, how to minimize random error? You do it by averaging. Now, how does averaging reduce random error? Let us look at this point also. Now, before we do that, let us look at the aspect of control in experiment. When do you say an experiment is well controlled? So, control implies awareness of all the variables in an experiment and the ability to vary them at will. So, you should be aware of all the variables in the experiment and you should be able to vary all the variables the way you want. This enables one to restrain sources of variability in research. Control also means a standard against which the effect of a particular variable can be compared. So, you are comparing against a standard, the measurement against a standard. The effects of all but the independent variable can be eliminated. Okay? Effects of all independent variable, effects of all variables except for the independent variable. Now, as we have mentioned in one of our earlier lectures, the several independent variables can be there and then you will have one effect. Now, how do you find out what is the relation between the different independent variables and the dependent variable? So, when you want to determine this, you must have one independent variable being changed and monitor the effect, and at that time the effects of other independent variables should not be there. This is one important thing that you should ensure in your experiment. This is what is the meaning of control, another meaning of control. Now, how can you ensure that? So, there are several ways of ensuring. It depends on the situation. So, the effects of all but the independent variable can be eliminated by either removing them. If you cannot remove them, by maintaining them constant or by screening them. There is a method called screening. You can screen the effect, or by counterbalancing. Counterbalancing means you cancel the effect of one variable with the other variable. And there is another approach that is called systematic randomization. Now, all these various methods are very, very important. I do not have the time to go through them. You can note down these words such as screening, counterbalancing and systematic randomization. And you can try to find out yourself. This is an assignment. Because removing them, one can understand. Maintaining a variable constant, this is also clear. Screening. What is the meaning of screening? It is clear, but how do you do screening, right? Please find out. How do you do counterbalancing? Some practical examples. And how do you do systematic randomization? We will see some example of how you can remove the effect when you cannot, how you can remove the effect of the variable other than independent variable when you cannot remove the variable or you cannot maintain it constant. One example we will see. Now, how can there be difficulty in control? Let us take some examples to illustrate how difficulties arise in control of experiments. Consider an experiment related to magnetostriction. So, what is magnetostriction? The experiment for measuring magnetostriction is shown on this paper slide. So, magnetostriction means change in the length of a material because of magnetism. Change in the length of the material because of magnetism. That is magnetostriction. you know that when you heat some material, it will elongate. So that is change in length because of heat. Like that, you can have change in length because of magnetism. Now, supposing you are doing an experiment to detect whether a particular material has this property of magnetostriction. So, a schematic diagram of the experiment would be like this. So, you have a solenoid to create the magnetic field, and inside this solenoid, you have a coil to create a magnetic field, and then inside that you put the material for which you want to measure the magnetostriction. Now, when you switch on the current, the magnetic field is created, and then you make the measurement of the length from this end to this end. And you indeed find, for example, suppose the length has increased. Supposing in a particular situation, you found the increase in length was, say, 0.005%. Increase in length because of magnetism. Now you are happy that, you know, yes, you have detected magnetostriction in the material. But unfortunately, what you have failed to notice is that when you pass current through the coil gets heated up. And because the coil is heated up, the material is heated up. And because the material is heated up, it will expand. Now, are you sure that the expansion that has happened, that you have detected or measured, is solely because of the magnetism and not because of the temperature? So what you have to do, you have to measure the coefficient of expansion because of thermal reasons of the material separately, and then you should try to see whether the expansion that has occurred here is more than that. Or you will have to find some method of measuring, keeping the temperature constant. But this is an example where you can see that when you want to increase the magnetic field, the temperature increases. Okay? So these are the kind of difficulties which are there in control. Another example, terminal velocity of a body in viscous liquid like glycerin. We have already discussed the apparatus by which you measure the terminal velocity. Now, as we have said, the temperature of the glycerin can go on increasing as you increase the number of trials of the experiment. So now, if you are measuring the terminal velocity as a function of, for example, diameter of the ball, you are doing an experiment to measure terminal velocity as a function of diameter. Suppose this is an experiment. Then you have balls of different diameter and you are going on doing experiment with the different balls. And you think that you have seen some trend. As the diameter increases, terminal velocity increases or decreases, whatever, you have seen some trend. And you think that is because of the viscosity of the medium. But the temperature of the medium has also changed. So how do you know that the terminal velocity behavior that you have measured is not because of temperature, right, and because of viscosity alone? So here again there is a problem in control. Then the third example is something that I already mentioned, gender differences in color preferences. Gender is confounded with past experience. So past experience is a confounding variable. Now in the previous examples, the effect of temperature is the confounding variable. Okay, in magnetostriction experiment and terminal velocity experiment. Now why should one be bothered about precision? Why should one try to be as precise as possible? So when experiments give results at variance with theoretical ideas, new discoveries are made. Right? This is the main reason why you must be bothered about precision. Let us consider two examples where precision played a role in great discoveries. Discovery of argon by Rayleigh and Ramsey. This first example. Now, how was argon discovered? Now, people knew that air contains nitrogen, oxygen, and traces of water vapor, carbon dioxide, and so on. This is what people had known before argon was discovered. Now, someone did an experiment to see the density of nitrogen that you get in two different two separate methods of getting nitrogen. So one approach was you remove the oxygen from air and you try to remove the moisture and so on also. Since you are not aware of any presence of any other gas, so you assume that if when you remove oxygen and traces of moisture and so on, what is left is nitrogen. So you measure the density of the remaining gas, let's put it like this. Now you think it is nitrogen, that is your hypothesis. Another experiment was done where nitrogen was produced from ammonia. That approach produces pure nitrogen, you are very sure it produces nitrogen. It was found that the density of the air that is left when you remove oxygen and moisture and so on was very marginally higher than the density of nitrogen that was produced from ammonia. Now, marginally means how much? It was just 0.5% higher. Now, many times you may say this 0.5% kind of error can occur in your measurement anyway. Why bother about it? But then, when they did the experiment very precisely, where this 0.5% also became significant, then, and they investigated the cause of this discrepancy, they found that you can explain this discrepancy by assuming that there is 1% argon, another gas of a particular weight and so on, which they called it as argon. So 1% of argon was detected, and that is how the argon was discovered. So you can see how precision is very important. Another example of discovery because of very high precision in experiment. Discovery of deuterium by Birge and Menzel, 1931, and Ure, Brickwede and Murphy, 1932. How did this discovery occur? So people produced hydrogen in two different ways and tried to measure the mass. You call it as atomic mass. One method was chemical determination, as shown on this slide, the paper slide. The chemical determination method, it gave the ratio of the mass of hydrogen that was obtained by this method to mass of oxygen with atomic mass of 16, particular isotope. Now this measurement was reported as shown here, that is 1.00799 plus or minus 0.00002. In a different experiment, the mass of hydrogen ratio, similar ratio, mass of hydrogen to mass of O16 was found to be 1.00778 plus or minus 0.00005. Now 1.00799 plus or minus 0.00002. What this means is your numerator can be anywhere between 1.00797 to 1.00801 numerator here. Here, however, the numerator can be 1.00773 to 1.00783. Now you see that this range is definitely lower than this range, even when you include the errors. So definitely here, the mass of hydrogen was different in this particular experiment than in the chemical determination method. Now once this difference was detected, and then it was hypothesized that you can explain this difference if you assume a very small percentage of hydrogen with atomic mass of 2 instead of 1, that is deuterium. So if you assume one part in 5000 of a hydrogen atom with atomic mass of 2, you can explain this discrepancy. And that is how, with further experiments, it was shown that yes, this is indeed correct. A spectrum of hydrogen was taken in a very sensitive experiment, and then it was found that you did have lines corresponding to a hydrogen atom of having a mass of 2 units. So this is another example where precision is very important. So if your this plus or minus value was much larger, you would not have detected any significant difference in the two cases. So this is where it was very, very important to reduce these numbers, which means you want your measurements to be made very precise. So this is how precision is very, very important in our experiments. So we can re-emphasize what we have said just now with another example. Significance of results depends on precision. If, for example, the measured resistance at two different temperatures is 2.00025 and 2.00034, we can say that temperature has an effect on the resistance. Can we say this? Yes, if the error is plus or minus 0.001 ohm. No, if the error is plus or minus 0.01 ohm. Why? Because you can see that if the error is plus or minus 0.001 ohm, then your values of resistance at 10 degree centigrade can be 200.024 to 200.026, and at 20 degree centigrade it would be 200.033 to 200.035. Now clearly the higher value here, the lower value here is significantly more than the upper bound here. So clearly at 20 degree centigrade the resistance is different than at 10 degree centigrade. So you can say yes, temperature has an effect. But supposing your error was 0.01 ohm, then your values would be 10 degree centigrade, 200.015 to 200.035. This is one range that is possible at 10 degree centigrade. At 20 degree centigrade, it is 200.024 to 200.044. Your measurement could have been anywhere bit in this range. Now you can see that 200.024, the lower end, lies in between 200.015 and 200.035. So supposing these were the actual values, then you find that as a function of temperature the resistance is decreasing. On the other hand, if these were the values, it is increasing. So you cannot discern any particular trend, okay, from here. So this is how precision is very, very important. So if you plot the same thing on a graph, I have now shown it in terms of numbers. I will leave it as an assignment that the same illustration can be much clearer if you were to plot the things on a graph, right? Your graph would look something like this. When the error is small, your two readings at 10 degree centigrade and 20 degree centigrade, this is resistance, this is temperature, they would be like this. So the maximum value here is less than the minimum value there. So you can clearly see, yes, there is an increase. This is when the error is 0.001. If the error is 0.01, what would happen is on a graph it would appear like this. This is how it would be. So now you cannot say, it may also be that the resistance is not changing at all, or it may be that it is decreasing, or it may be increasing. Okay? But in this case, it is very clear. So this is how this actually represents, this length represents the precision or the extent of random errors. How much precision? Now we have seen that precision is important. Now how much precision we should aim at? It depends on the purpose of the experiment. If a resistance is to be used as a standard in the range 10 to 20 degree centigrade and the precision required is 0.01%, an error of 0.01 plus or minus ohm is adequate, and it is unnecessary to reduce the error to plus or minus 0.001. Okay? So in your experiment, you should have an idea of how much precision is required. So this is another skill that you should have. Now each of these points can be discussed in great detail with further examples. So you can have several hours of experimental skill, right? Courses on experimental skill. So here I am just pointing out the important issues. You can read up on your own. You know what kind of research you are doing. The goal of this discussion is to make you aware of the various issues. You can read up the required material and then understand these issues in depth.